परित्राणाय साधुनाम विनाशाय चतुष्कृताम धर्म संस्थापनार्थाय संभवामि युगे युगे. Even Lord Krishna said that for the establishment of law and dharma, both the protection of innocents and elimination of miscreants are equally warranted. Honorable Chairman, esteemed jury, and my dear learned co-participants, this is Devesh Tripathi, Assistant Commandant, CISF, speaking for the motion, and I vehemently claim that human rights cannot be nurtured, preserved, or even survive without the Fort Knox of national security. The paradigm of national security is not to protect individual human rights, but for the larger interests of the individuals as a collectivity, and to protect and preserve the sovereignty and integrity of the nation, maintain law and order, internal security, and to fight against the menaces of terrorism, Naxalism, and questions of secession, etc. International jurist Hugo Grotius says that countries have been given certain rights and responsibilities to perform sovereign functions, and international covenants such as ICCPR and 4th Geneva Convention give legitimate scope of incurring collateral damage on the basis of necessity and proportionality, and even suspending human rights in national exigencies. But the paradoxical situation is that while there is increasing and widespread concern for the observance of human rights by security forces operating in most gruesome environment, gross violations of the same by the militant organizations goes unabated. The countermeasures by the security forces are often restrained when the militants blend into local population, making it impossible to attack their base without collateral damage. We are expected to be miraculous doctor who has to cure a tumor, but without using a scalpel and without causing pain. Damned if we do, damned if we don't. Security forces do observe human rights. Yes, Honorable Chairman, security forces do observe human rights even at stake of their life, their effectiveness, and the terrorists misusing it to their own advantage. Remember those jawans in election duties who had AK-47 to secure ballot boxes but didn't raise even their eyebrows when they were punched, humiliated, and even spit upon in the streets of Kashmir. We also forget that security forces were the first to constitute human rights cell under Human Rights Act of 1993, even before NHRC itself was established. But the grey area of debate are those extraordinary exigencies when certain rights of individuals become subservient to national interest and stern actions are warranted. It is in this spirit that Honorable Justice Umanath Singh, speaking for full bench of Meghalaya High Court on 3rd November 2015, specifically asked the central government to implement APSPA in certain militancy hit Garo Hills of Meghalaya to restore peace and rule of law. Statistically, in 2018, World Economic Forum quantified the effects of terrorism over the economic growth of the countries and reported that India suffered a setback of 0.91% in 2003, further escalating to more than 2% in 2016. As per NCRB, civilian casualties suffered due to terrorist and Naxal-related attacks rose from 2,597 in 2003 to a staggering 5,512 in 2016. Isn't it a matter of national security to ensure a halt to this mass massacre of innocent civilians? Or should we still be talking about utopian idealism of human rights when Constable Sikandar of Sashastra Seema Bal is dragged out of his 5-year-old daughter's birthday party in Jammu last year and is shot and mutilated by 25 Maoists in front of that poor kid? Honorable Chairman, the irony is that nobody points a finger when every rule of flight safety and standard operating procedure are broken by we security forces in suicidal weather conditions to save people from Kerala floods and Jammu Kashmir floods almost annually. But isolated act of tying Farooqi Ahmed at the front of Jeep as a preemptive measure to secure several others from an imminent threat of death by ruthless stone pelters became such a heinous issue of human rights. But on a lighter note, if given a chance, I'm sure my worthy opponents will come here and will heartfully cry that security forces failed to protect that poor kid from Bangalore who wished to migrate to Syria for the noble cause of joining that auspicious organization named as Islamic State. Or those noble missionaries such as Burhan Wani or Dujana who were killed, depriving us of their immense talent and potential of becoming Hafiz Saeed and who knows, Masood Azhar of the future. Honorable Chairman, Sun Tzu says in his Art of War that there cannot be a good war or a bad peace. Honorable Justice Madan Lokur of Supreme Court in famous Encounter Association case of 2016 categorically stated that national security is paramount importance in terrorist activities and proportionate retaliation in security force operation is legally justified with impunity, and here I stand. And here I stand to answer my worthy opponents who cry for Afzal Guru because national security provides them that luxury under the blanket of freedom that we provide, and they don't even light a candle when Maoist killed 10 CRPF jawan in an ambush and brutally cut open the stomach of one of them to stuff a bomb inside his bleeding intestine. At the end, I'll exclaim with pride and honor that my wife, my family, and of all those in uniform know it very well that our death in preserving human rights and national security is a necessary concomitant of our duties so that the nation sleeps peacefully and debates conveniently. Thank you so much.